Welcome everyone to GIA Knowledge Sessions, a series of talks and seminars about gemology that are fueled by decades worth of investigation and research. I'm Robert Weldon. I'm the director of the GIA Library, and I'm joined by my esteemed colleagues, Dr. Aaron Palke, the Senior Manager of Research of Colored Stones and Identification, and Judy Colbert, who is the Manager of Visual Resources in the Library, and whom I have the distinct pleasure of working with every day. Before we get started, just a bit of housekeeping. Everyone attending this is automatically muted. Now, if you have a question, please submit it using the Q&A feature that you'll see at the bottom of your screen there. Feel free to ask questions as we go along. There will be a Q&A session at the end where Dr. Palke and Judy will have the opportunity to answer some of your questions. We'll also send a recording of the session to you later today, and that message will also have a survey. So we'd love to hear your feedback. And with that, I'm going to pass you over to Judy.
Thank you, Robert. Mineralogist and author George Frederick Coons once wrote, "It is impossible to overestimate the effect of color in determining the supposed influence of gems upon the fortunes or health of the wearers." What does the color green represent? It's the color of spring and rebirth. It also symbolizes peace. It's the color of the olive branch. Green has a soothing, restful reputation, but too much can give off a sense of inertia. It encourages balanced judgment and is a good color for courtrooms or legal offices. Its reputed healing properties are well suited for hospitals and operating rooms. But green is also the color of envy or jealousy. Some believe the color green has been associated with jealousy dating back to the ancient Greeks. They believe jealousy occurred as a result of the overproduction of bile, which turned human skin slightly green. Because of its association with fairies, green was thought to be unlucky by some. For the superstitious, sending a get well card containing the color green can worsen the health of the recipient. Modern birth stone lists were compiled by the retail jewelers associations based on calendar months. At first, people wanted to own all 12 stones, wearing a different one for each month. But later, each person wore the stone of the month in which they were born. The next slide, please. I'll start with emerald. It's the May birthstone, said to discover false friends and ensure true love. The name comes from the Greek word smaragdos, which means green stone. It's thought to give the wearer ability to foretell the future. And if you dream of emeralds, it means you have much to look forward to. Pliny, the Roman authority on gems, believed that emerald outgreened nature itself. "No other color," he wrote, "is so pleasing to the sight. For grass and green foliage we view indeed with pleasure. But emeralds with so much greater delight, inasmuch as nothing in creation compared with them equals the intensity of their green. Besides, they're the only gems that fill the eye with their view, yet do not fatigue it." Many believe that emeralds had curative powers for eyesight. The history of the emerald and its availability goes back well into antiquity. Well known in Babylon and Egypt, emeralds were owned and worn regularly by royalty. Mines in southern Egypt near the Red Sea were the source of Cleopatra's famous stones, which she favored along with pearls. Emeralds from Egypt were sent to Rome, where they became a symbol of wealth because of their rarity. Marbode, the Bishop of Rennes and author of the earliest lapidary book on gemstones in the Middle Ages, wrote that the emerald improves memory, makes its owner eloquent and persuasive, and brings joy. Emerald's importance really began when Marco Polo brought some back to Europe from his travels during the last two decades of the 13th century. And three centuries later, the fame of the emerald was further enhanced by the fabulous stones sent back to Spain from Mexico, Peru, and Colombia by the conquistadores. Anselmus de Boot, in 1609, famous mineralogist, alchemist, and physician, recommended emerald as the most powerful amulet to prevent epilepsy, stop bleeding, cure dysentery and fever, and avert panic. Next slide, please. One of the most famous uses of emeralds is in the crown of the Andes. It's set with over 400 emeralds, and the largest is 24 carats. The crown was made to adorn a sacred statue of the Virgin Mary in the Cathedral of Popayan in Colombia. The diadem was made around 1660, and the arches were added later, about 1770. It was sold to a private individual with permission from Pope Pius X in 1914, and it changed hands several times before it was purchased in 2015 by the Metropolitan Museum of Art in New York. Previous owners have included Oscar Heyman and Brothers and the Asher Diamond Company. And there's a picture of Mr. Lidicote, our former president, admiring it at displays where it was exhibited for promotion. Next, and I'll give it to Aaron.
Thanks, Judy. So while Judy's going to cover a lot of the history and lore of these gemstones, I'm going to cover a little more of the technical aspects. So I'll walk you guys through a little bit of the basic gemology, and a lot of what I'll go over for the technical aspects is kind of the causes of color for these green gemstones. So we're here with emerald. Basically, basic gemology, if you were to try to identify an emerald with basic gemological tools, basically emerald is the green gem variety of the mineral beryl. So beryl is a beryllium aluminum silicate mineral. It's uniaxial negative, Ri from 1.577 to 1.583, Sg of 2.72, typically inert fluorescence, maybe weak orangey red, some low iron emeralds from like Colombia, for instance. And treatments, you'll often see clarity enhancement with emeralds. So this is something to look out for in gemologically is clarity enhancement. These emeralds often have fractures, and the fractures can be filled with resins and epoxies and oils, which can work to hide those fractures and improve the clarity a little bit. So with these basic properties, you could probably go out with some basic gemological tools and identify a cut emerald stone with fair confidence. So let's talk a little bit more though about what causes green in an emerald. And this isn't the green stone, of course. This is a what we would call a goshenite, which is a colorless beryl. And so what I want to get across here is that beryl on its own, so if you were to take simply a beryllium aluminum silicate mineral, none of those atoms in beryl, so you have aluminum, beryllium, silicon, and oxygen, and that crystal structure is shown there on the right, the way in which these atoms are arranged, none of these atoms on their own will absorb any visible wavelengths of light. And so when you take white light going into your colorless beryl, it passes back out as white light because none of the white light is absorbed. However, if we take some chromium ions, if we take some of those aluminum atoms shown in these octahedra here, the grayish kind of polyhedra, if we take some of those aluminum atoms out and replace them with chromium atoms, now all of a sudden we get this green color in the beryl. And so what's going on is that as light enters this beryl, this emerald, some of that light gets absorbed, allowing only the green light to be transmitted back to our eyes. Now we can take a little closer look at this. This is a absorption spectrum. So this is a visible light absorption spectrum. You might also hear it called a UV vis absorption spectrum because it does show a little bit of the ultraviolet light. But essentially this is showing on the horizontal axis all of the visible wavelengths of light. So from 380 nanometers, where we see a violet type light, going into the blue, the green, the yellow, and the orange, as the wavelength gets longer, the color changes into eventually the red in around the 700-780 nanometer region. And so these are all the lights, wavelengths of light that can cause color when they're picked up by our eyes. And what you're seeing on the vertical axis is absorbance. So this squiggly line here shows how absorbance changes over the different wavelengths of light. So at any specific wavelength of light, this tells you how much of the light going through the stone gets picked up or transmitted. When absorbance is high, that means a lot of that wavelength of light gets absorbed. So a lot of the blue and a lot of the red and orange wavelengths of light get absorbed when you have chromium in this beryl mineral. On the other hand, where the absorbance is low, that's where you get a lot of that light transmitted. And it just so happens that when you put chromium into a beryl mineral, the absorbance in this green region is very low. The chromium does not absorb green light very well. So all of that green light passing through the emerald gets right back out through the stone and comes back to our eyes, producing this green color. And if you've ever seen a spectroscope, if you've taken any GIA gemology courses, you've probably looked in a spectroscope and you may have seen a pattern like this for an emerald. This is a characteristic emerald pattern, emerald spectroscope pattern. You see the dark patches in the spectroscope very clearly align themselves with these areas of high absorption in the gemstone. You also see these kind of faint sharp lines here for where the chromium also is absorbing light. It's a typical spectroscope pattern. Now, one thing to note, though, is that chromium is not the only chromophore in emerald. And what I mean by chromophore is any color-producing element or defect in the crystalline lattice that causes color. So for emeralds, vanadium is also a very important chromophore. And actually, for certain deposits, especially in Colombia, vanadium can be the dominant cause of color in these emeralds. And so I'm showing two spectra here. The spectrum on the bottom is actually a vanadium-dominant emerald. It's got about 1,000 ppm or 1,000 parts per million vanadium and only about 300 parts per million chromium. If you're unfamiliar with this parts per million terminology, what this means is essentially if you have 1,000 parts per million vanadium, 1,000 atoms in that structure are out of a million will be vanadium. So that's also about 0.1% vanadium in the structure. And you can see on the spectrum on the top is a chromium dominant emerald. So it's got only about 80 parts per million vanadium, but 1400 parts per million chromium. And what you'll see is these absorption peaks line up quite well between the chromium and the vanadium dominant emeralds. So in this structure, both chromium and vanadium produce very similar colors and when you put them into beryl. This is gonna be different for some other minerals that we'll talk about later where chromium and vanadium actually produce different colors. And we'll get to that a little more later. Now, one final thing to note with beryl in general is that vanadium and chromium aren't the only way you can make green color in beryl. And so there's another variety of beryl that we simply call green beryl. And this is beryl with sort of a lighter tone green, a lower saturation green color. And the color is not generally from chromium or vanadium in this case. The color is often from iron. And the other interesting thing about this is that there's more than one type of iron. You have to have two different kinds of chromophores in this case in order to produce the green color. So there's different types of iron you can put in the structure. There's something we call iron 3+. So this is an iron atom that is missing three electrons. And iron 3+ on its own in beryl creates a yellow color. Now, in order to create green from yellow, you have to add some blue. So we also have this iron 2+ iron 3+ intervalence charge transfer. So this is where you have an iron 2+ atom missing two electrons next to an iron 3+ ion missing three electrons. If they're situated right next to each other in the crystal lattice of beryl, certain wavelengths of light will cause an electron to jump between the two ions of iron. And this is the cause of the kind of typical classic blue color in aquamarine. So when you add these two chromophores together, you get this green color in green beryl. You'll also see in the spectrum this big broad absorption peak at about 800 nanometers. This is caused by iron 2+ on its own. It's altering the color a little bit in this case, but most of the color is really coming from this iron 3+ and iron 3+, iron 2+ intervalence charge transfer. And so with that, I'm going to hand it back to Judy to talk about green diamonds.
Thanks, Aaron. Diamonds are the birthstone of April, and the name comes from the Greek word adamas, meaning invincible because of its hardness. Because of their rarity, there's little lore for green diamonds in particular, so I'll mention some that pertains to diamonds in general. A widely held belief, first mentioned in the Talmud, was that the diamond would change color to dark or brilliant according to the guilt or innocence of the wearer. If you dream of diamonds, it's said that you'll have victory over your enemies. The diamond was also believed to be a test for fidelity, because it was said a stone placed on the breast of a sleeping loved one caused the sleeper to tell the most intimate of his or her secrets. In medieval times, diamonds were thought to be a valuable charm against plague and sorcery and aided its wearer in performing heroic deeds. Next slide, please. A very famous green diamond is the Dresden Green, named after the capital of Saxony, one of the cultural centers of Europe in the 18th century. The 40.7 carat pear-shaped diamond, reputed to have come from the Golconda region of India, was purchased at the Leipzig Easter Fair in 1741 by Friedrich Augustus II, Elector of Saxony and the King of Poland. Eventually, it was set into a hat ornament and has been housed in the Dresden Green Vault, except for times of war when it was moved for safety. The diamond had a close call from being stolen in November of 2019, when thieves broke into the Dresden Castle, making off with an estimated $1 billion worth of treasures from the Green Vault. As luck would have it, the Dresden Green was on loan at the time to the Metropolitan Museum of Art in New York. Very lucky stone indeed. All right, Aaron.
Thanks, Judy. So for the kind of technical aspects of green diamonds, most commonly green diamonds get their green color from radiation. And while this word radiation seem a little scary to gemologists first, because it invokes memories of artificially irradiated stones, especially colored stones get irradiated a lot in order to enhance or change their color. However, with green diamonds in particular, this radiation-induced color can be natural as well. And so these photomicrographs on the right are showing some examples of the surface of some natural green color diamonds. And so what happens is essentially the way we envision this is the diamonds are erupted onto the Earth's surface and interred or stored in secondary alluvial deposits. In these cases, these diamonds are surrounded by different rocks and minerals and grains of different minerals and potentially fluids circulating through the deposit as well. And so either the fluids that are circulating through the deposit or the mineral grains adhering to the surface of the diamond, either of those can contain radioactive elements that might then cause some radiation damage on the surface of the natural diamond. And you'll see also these, that's kind of shown in these photos where you can kind of see the imprint of these former grains that were stuck next to the diamond when they were in these deposits. And so this might be something you could look for in some cases for some green diamonds in order to determine the cause of color. What's going on in kind of a crystallographic sense is that you have the diamond lattice, diamonds made up of only carbon atoms, right? And so if you take a source of intense radiation, either natural or artificial, what you can do is this radiation might knock one of these carbon atoms completely out of the lattice. And you'll end up with this hole, essentially. You end up with what we would call a vacancy. A vacancy is a site in the crystallographic lattice that should be occupied by an atom, but is now empty. And when this happens, the carbon atoms that should have been attached to that missing vacancy, to the carbon in the missing vacancy, those nearby carbon atoms are now kind of electronically unhappy. The electrons that used to be bonded to that carbon now have nowhere to go, and they create this altered electronic state for those nearby carbon atoms. And this allows for this vacancy itself to be able to absorb certain wavelengths of light through electronic transitions. This is shown here in a little more detail. These are absorption spectra for some green diamonds. From the region of about 550 to about 750 nanometers, there's all of these associated absorption features that are related to these vacancies created by the radiation. And so this causes, in essence, this transmission window occurring right here, right about 500 nanometers, allowing all the green light to get through because of these vacancy-related defects in the structure. Now, the thing is that there's two spectra here. The top spectrum is showing a treated color diamond, and the bottom spectrum is showing a natural color diamond. And you can see, obviously, the absorption spectrum in both cases is very similar. So this is actually quite kind of a tricky situation in many cases. It can be very tricky to separate natural color and treated color green diamonds. And so, as Judy mentioned, the Dresden diamond is this really spectacular historic piece. And actually, in the late 80s, some of our geologists from GIA actually got the chance to go and visit and study the Dresden Green. And there's a really wonderful report they put out in Gems and Gemology, the winter 1990 issue of Gems and Gemology. One of the reasons they wanted to study it, because this is really a classic example of a known natural green diamond that they wanted to maybe compare to use to see if they could provide some criteria for identifying similar natural green diamonds in the lab. So if you're more curious about the Dresden Green, I suggest you go check out this article in the winter 1990 issue of Gems and Gemology online at gia.edu, free of charge, of course. And with that, I'm going to hand it back over to Judy to talk about peridot.
Hey, thanks, Aaron. Peridot is one of August's birthstones. It's my birthstone, too. It's also one of the oldest known gemstones. Pliny confused it with green topaz. The Crusaders thought they were emeralds and brought the stones back to Europe for churches to put into ornamental objects during the Middle Ages. Romans wore it to repel terror, enchantment, and melancholy. In the Middle Ages, it was a charm against the evil spirits of the night. Historically found in quantity on the island of Zabergad, St. John's Island in the Red Sea, which is about 50 miles from Egypt. Next slide, please. It was one of the favorite gems in Victorian England. King Edward VII of England chose it as his talisman. Dr. Frederick Poe, a notable geologist, told of an unusual method of finding peridot in Arizona. Tiny peridot pebbles withstand weathering better than the surrounding rock. Ants would tunnel through the area, pushing the peridot pebbles, which were in their way, out into a waste pile where people would find them. The finest peridots are viewed best in artificial light because the color shows up darker. Because of this, they've been called the evening emerald. Aaron, up to you.
Thanks, Judy. So a little bit about the gemology and the causes of color in peridot. So peridot is the green gem variety of the mineral olivine, which is a magnesium iron silicate found in a lot of basalts and ultramafic rocks and also deep within the earth in the mantle. It's biaxial, can be positive or negative depending on the chemistry, how much magnesium or iron is in the stone. The refractive index is 1.654 to 1.690. And particular of note is that this is a very big difference in the extremes of the RI. So there's a lot of birefringence in peridot, which I'll get to on the next slide. Specific gravity is 3.34 and it's inert to fluorescence. So this is an absorption spectrum of peridot. And what you'll see is that I'm not showing just one spectrum, I'm showing three spectra. And this gets back to what I was saying about the birefringence. There's a big difference in the refractive index of light going through the peridot, depending on the direction the light is traveling through the crystal. And so the reason this is happening is because peridot is an anisotropic mineral. It's biaxial. So when unpolarized light passes through the peridot, it actually splits into two different polarized rays of light. And these two different polarized rays of light travel through the stone differently in different directions, and they have different geometries in which they travel through the stone. And so what happens is this cut stone is a really good example of this. You can see the reflections of the pavilion on the bottom side of the stone are quite fuzzy. And this is because as the light came through the crown, it then split into two rays, and those two rays continued to split further and further as they traveled through the stone, causing the reflections to come out differently in different parts of the stone. And so what's going on is that you can see on this, the crystal on the right as well. This kind of really shows a good example of what you're seeing in the spectrum on the left. If you were to take this crystal, you could crystallographically orient it to the different crystallographic axes, and you could get a UV-Vis spectrum down each different crystallographic axis with polarized light. And you could get these three distinct, unique components of the polarization of this absorption spectrum of this peridot. So what this is exactly what this is showing. There are three spectra here showing the three crystallographic directions along which light can vibrate when it passes through the peridot. However, all three of these absorption spectra show very similar properties. These are all caused by the presence of iron 2+ in the peridot structure. And all of these absorption features essentially cause this big transmission window right there in the green, causing the color of peridot in this mineral. One further thing to note with peridot before we move on to the next stone is that one really cool type of peridot is called palisadic peridot. And it's kind of really, as far as I'm aware, the only extraterrestrial gemstone that we really use these days. It's found in this type of meteorite called a palisadic meteorite, which is composed of these chunks of olivine or peridot set in this matrix of an iron nickel rich metal. And from a scientific perspective, this is really interesting because we think it could be a relic of the boundary between the iron-rich core and the rocky mantle of some asteroid, or it might be caused by the collision of two different asteroids and the mixing of the iron-rich core and the rocky mantle material in these asteroids. But whatever the cause, it's really a unique mineral. They come generally in quite small sizes, so these are going to be really small stones shown there on the left. And it's a really kind of a unique collector stone because of its really unique geological origin. So on to green tourmaline. Back to you, Judy.
Yep, thanks. Tourmaline is the alternative birthstone for October. It wasn't widely known as its own species until the 18th century, because of its similarity to other stones. The name comes from the Sinhalese word termali, which means colored stone. The first known tourmalines were sent to Holland from Ceylon, now known as Sri Lanka. It's been wrongly referred to as Brazilian emerald, Brazilian peridot, or peridot of Ceylon. Helen Hunt Jackson, author of the 19th century American novel Ramona, wrote a short story published in 1874 titled My Tourmaline, under the pen name Sax Holm. It's set in Maine, and it tells the story of a little girl who finds a crystal in the roots of a tree and sprains her leg trying to remove it. While confined to her bed to convalesce, she keeps the stone in a silk bag and places it against her cheek. She feels a prickly, tickling sensation that helps her to sleep. And the reference is the ability of tourmaline to conduct an electrical charge when heated or rubbed. Next slide, please. It's been called the peace stone, since it supposedly dispels fears and makes its wearer calm. It was traditionally used to heal the eyes and stimulate the body's cleansing systems. If you dream of tourmalines, it's supposed to foretell an accident. Green tourmaline is said to be particularly good for people engaged in business because it's supposed to attract success. Next, Aaron.
Thanks, Judy. So a little bit about the kind of gemology and science of tourmaline. So I'm showing the chemical formula, the general chemical formula of the supergroup of tourmaline minerals here. And so when I say it's a supergroup, that means that tourmaline doesn't refer to just one mineral species. Tourmaline is this group of mineral species that all have kind of similar properties and similar chemistry. Now, this chemical formula looks quite complicated, right? It's got a lot of different letters in there. What I would note is these letters X, Y, Z, and V, and W, and T, these are not referencing any specific element, but these are referencing specific crystallographic sites in the tourmaline mineral in which you can put a lot of different types of elements. And this is why there's so much diversity in the mineral species in the tourmaline supergroup. For green tourmalines, the ones we're most interested in are going to be elbite, dravite, and uvite. So I'm showing the chemical formula here. These are kind of specific chemical formula where you would take specific elements and put them into those general crystallographic sites. So for instance, for elbite, we put sodium into the X site, lithium and aluminum into the Y site, aluminum into the Z site, and silicon into the T site. And this forms the mineral elbite, a sodium, lithium, aluminum, silicate, tourmaline. Now, dravite would be a sodium, magnesium, aluminum, silicate, tourmaline, and uvite would be calcium, magnesium, aluminum, and silicon in that tourmaline. Some gemology, so tourmaline generally uniaxial negative, refractive index from 1.624 to 1.644, specific gravity of 3.06, although there's some variability in this when you start changing the chemistry and going to different tourmaline species. Generally, it's inert fluorescence and maybe weak red fluorescence in some cases. And there might be some tourmalines that are low temperature heat treated. Now, this example here is an elbite tourmaline. In elbite tourmalines, iron is really the dominant cause of color for green color in tourmaline. And we have this kind of standard iron 2 plus absorption feature here. Iron 2 plus in a lot of minerals, a lot of silicate minerals especially, tends to absorb light right here in about 700 nanometers. It tends to be had kind of a broad absorption band at about 700 nanometers, which absorbs a lot of the red light and creates this transmission window for the green light to come back through the stone. With uvite and dravite, the green color tends to be caused by a different chromophore. In this case, it's chromium itself. So this is also kind of like a standard chromium absorption feature where there's two broad absorption features. The position of these chromium absorption features will change based on the mineral, but it just so happens that in uvite and dravite, those chromium peaks occur kind of in the red and then in the blue, which allows this transmission window of green light to come back through the stone. And now here's another example. I know what you're saying. This is not a green stone, of course. This is blue. Some tourmalines can be colored by chrome, by copper as well. And these are more specifically these Paraíba tourmalines, found originally in the Paraíba state in Brazil, but now also found in Nigeria and Mozambique. The copper is causing this bright, neon, intense blue color, which can also be altered a little bit by the iron, which is absorbed in this region as well. But this copper in tourmaline absorbs a lot of the red light allowing a lot of that blue light to come through the stone in the absence of any other chromophores. However, pyrite tourmaline can also be green. And so in this case, you have the same copper absorbing feature here, about 700 nanometers, absorbing a lot of that red light. But in this case, you also see this rise in the absorption as you go to shorter and shorter wavelengths. So as you go from into the blue and the violet regions at short wavelengths, we start absorbing a lot of that light, which forces that transmission window to longer wavelengths and more into the green. And what's going on here is that in addition to the copper and maybe some iron, we also have this manganese titanium intervalence charge transfer. So this is where you have a manganese ion and a titanium ion in the crystal lattice and adjacent sites. And certain wavelengths of light will cause an electron to jump between the titanium and manganese, creating this yellowish color that you're adding to the blue from the copper, creating this intense neon green as a result. And that band is about, or that absorption feature is at about 350 nanometers. You can't really see the whole feature there, but it's causing this yellow color here, altering the blue to a green. And so with that, I'm gonna hand it back over to Judy for bloodstone.
Thanks, sir. Bloodstone's one of the March birthstones. It symbolizes steadfast affection, courage, and wisdom. It was long thought to have magical powers to control the weather and to banish evil. One legend is that the name bloodstone comes from the belief that it was first formed when drops of Christ's blood fell on some pieces of dark green jasper lying at the foot of the cross. The ancient name for it was heliotrope and is still preferred in Germany. That name comes from helios, Greek word for sun, and tropos, meaning change. Pliny wrote, "If placed in a vessel of water and bright sunshine falls upon it, in reflecting the sunlight, it changes it into the color of blood. When it is out of the water, the same stone catches sunlight like a mirror and detects solar eclipses." However, Pliny renounced a belief that it would confer invisibility to the wearer. Babylonians made many seals and amulets of the stone, which were also favored by Roman gladiators because it was supposed to stop the flow of blood from wounds. Next slide, please. The Victorians wore it to signal, "I mourn your absence." Another curative power attributed to bloodstone is that when it's ground into powder and mixed with honey and egg white, it's a cure for tumors. It's also said to draw out the poison of snakes. If you dream of bloodstone, it may mean distressing news is on the way. Next slide, please, Aaron. I'll talk about jade. The name jade refers to two different species of gemstones, jadeite and nephrite. Jade is an important stone in Asian culture and mythology dating back over 6,000 years. It had both practical and ornamental uses. It was used for tools, weapons, musical instruments, and currency, among other things. Chinese emperors believed jade was the essence of heaven and earth and used it to communicate with the gods and had it carved into statues to worship. Jade had importance in burial rituals as well. Liu Sheng, a king of the Western Han Dynasty, died around 113 BCE. He was buried in a jade suit made of 2,498 pieces of jade stitched together with gold thread. Confucius compared the 11 virtues of jade to the qualities of noble men: benevolence, intelligence, morality, virtue, music, honesty, propriety, loyalty, integrity, heaven, and earth. Next slide, please. Jade was revered in other cultures as well. The Maya and Aztecs of Mesoamerica considered it as a symbol of royalty and eternal life. Maya kings would adorn themselves with it in life and were surrounded by it in death. The Maoris of New Zealand wore talismans of greenstone, as jade was known, to ensure long life and fertility. Jade is said to promote a sense of caring for others and encourages feelings of unconditional love. Believed to strengthen the heart and the kidneys, improve circulation, cure asthma and diseases of the blood, and heal migraines. Early physicians believed jade could cool the forehead of a child burning with fever. Other beliefs are that if you keep a piece of jade by your bedside, it'll bolster the immune system. And if you keep an ornamental jade object in your home, it'll bring harmony and wealth. Aaron?
Thanks, Judy. So a little bit about the gemology and science behind jade. So jade is, as Judy mentioned, an ornamental material. It's a polycrystalline material, often carved or fashioned into beads and bangles. And so when I say it's a polycrystalline material, I kind of mean it's like a rock, right? So if you look at the picture on the right, these are some jadeite boulders, some jadeite jade boulders that have been sun in half to show essentially what's inside of the stone. And so this kind of illustrates the difficulty when buying and selling jadeite and nephrite jade and when choosing pieces to carve. So if you look at the rough material, it can be difficult to understand what's going on inside of the stone, to see what might lie beneath in order for you to be able to carve it. If you're people who know a lot about this and have a lot of experience buying and selling jade, might look for subtle clues about what's going on inside the stone, but it can be a gamble and it can be risky times to buy and sell a certain piece of jade. However, if you make the right choice and you get the right stone, you can produce some absolutely brilliant carvings, of course. As Judy mentioned, there's two different flavors of jade, right? There's jadeite jade and nephrite jade. Jadeite jade is formed dominantly of this mineral jadeite, which is a sodium aluminum silicate mineral, a pyroxene. And nephrite jade is dominantly composed of a calcium magnesium iron rich amphibole mineral, often actinolite or similar minerals. So we'll consider these two types of jade separately. For jadeite, the top color jadeite, the really rich green luscious jadeite jade, is dominantly caused by the presence of chromium. And this is kind of the typical A-type jade, what people call A-type jade. In this case, we have, again, this very kind of standard chromium absorption feature where you have absorption bands in the blue and the red, allowing all that green light to be transmitted through the stone. However, jadeite can also be colored by the presence of iron on its own. So you don't necessarily need chromium, but that chromium can lend kind of a richer, deeper green color. If you have only iron in the stone, you get this typical iron absorption feature at about 700 nanometers, absorbing a lot of that red light. And then iron 3+, on the other hand, causes this rise in absorption in the blue, and it has this sharp absorption feature at about 450 nanometers. And that, again, allows all that green light to be transmitted through the stone and coming back to our eyes. Now, with nephrite, it's kind of a similar situation. Now, again, I'm showing this spectrum with these three different spectra, alpha, beta, and gamma. And what this is showing is these are not actually spectra from a piece of jade of nephrite jade. These are actually spectra from a single crystal amphibole. So this is what would be the mineral that is in bulk is composing the nephrite jade. And so this mineral itself is anisotropic. It's a biaxial mineral. So there's three different ways in which light can pass through the stone in different directions, giving different absorption features. And so what you'll see, these are all iron-related features. We have, again, these iron-related features around 700 nanometers and the rise in absorption in the blue caused by iron as well, with the result that in any direction in this nephrite, in these amphibole minerals forming the nephrite, you get this green transmission window caused by the presence of iron. And then on to Judy for some discussion of malachite.
Thank you. The name comes from the Greek malachy, meaning mallow, which is a flowering plant sometimes used for medicinal purposes. It was known in Egypt as early as 3000 BC, where it was used as jewelry and amulets and even powder for eyeshadow. Italians wore it as an amulet against the evil eye. It was used as a talisman to protect children from evil spirits. Malachite was one of the stones dedicated to St. Francis of Assisi. Legend has it that when malachite is held in the hand or worn as a jewel, it will enable one to understand the language of animals. There are many therapeutic uses attributed to malachite. It supposedly relieves or cures cold sweats, malaria, tremors, cholera, and Parkinson's disease. It's also said to help those who suffer short-term memory loss, like forgetting the names of people they've just met. Next slide, please. Okay, now we'll talk about the green garnets. Although there's very little lore surrounding these gems because they're relatively new discoveries in the gem world, there are a number of mystical and therapeutic properties attributed to garnets in general. They're the January birthstone, and if you gift it to someone you love, it's supposed to ensure long-lasting love and fidelity. Victorian widows would wear it to signify their undying fidelity to their departed spouses. It is said to assist you in becoming clear about a situation or light your path, and that it will protect you on trips or long journeys. If you carry a garnet with you, it may bring you hope and the power to succeed in hopeless situations. If you dream of garnets, it's supposed to mean you'll find a solution to a mystery and also means you'll accumulate wealth. Demantoid. It's a relatively new gemstone. It was first discovered in the Ural Mountains of Russia in the mid-1800s and was originally thought to be peridot. In the 1870s, Finnish mineralogist Nils von Nordenskjöld, who identified it as a new variety of andradite garnet, proposed the name demantoid, meaning diamond-like, because of its strong fire and brilliance. It quickly became a favorite with the Russian nobility and set into jewelry by Peter Carl Fabergé and other Russian court jewelers. Some of the intense green stones, which were less popular with the Russians, were exported to Europe at high prices. King Edward VII of England, who favored green gems, popularized demantoids in Edwardian jewelry of the late 19th and early 20th century. The popularity of these gems diminished with the onset of the Bolshevik Revolution in 1917, along with other symbols of Russian wealth and royalty. Since that time, it has regained its desirability, and a new discovery was located in Africa in the mid-1990s. Savorite. Because of its rarity, savorite may not be as well known as some of the other green gems. This green garnet was first discovered by the late Campbell Bridges in 1961. He was on a geological expedition in Zimbabwe searching for beryl deposits when a buffalo chased him into a gully. There, he found an outcrop of small green crystals, later identified as green Groschler garnet. In 1967, he found larger crystals in northern Tanzania, and later in the early 1970s in Kenya near Tsavo National Park. It was given the name Savorite by Henry Platt, then president of Tiffany and Company, and Campbell Bridges. Tiffany started marketing it in 1974 and brought the relatively obscure stone into the public consciousness. Its bright, vivid green color is the essence of spring. Over to you, Aaron.
Thanks, Judy. So we're talking about garnets, and I'm going to cover both the demantoid and Savorite garnets together. With green garnets, we're typically talking about what we call ugrandite garnets. So ugrandite garnets are those garnets that are rich in calcium. I'm showing kind of the general mineral formula for the ugrandite garnets. We have calcium, we have X, meaning this is different types of elements, and we have silicon in there. And that site occupied by the X can be aluminum, chromium, or vanadium, or iron as well. I forgot iron in that formula. So in savorite garnets, that X site is occupied by aluminum. In demantoid garnets, it's occupied by iron 3+. It's singly refractive index from 1.740 for Groschler to over the limit for demantoid garnets. Specific gravity can vary from 3.61 to 3.84, inert to fluorescence, and typically not treated very often, but some demantoids are reported to be heated at low temperatures. So we'll start off with demantoid. So demantoid is the green gem variety of the andradite garnet, as Judy mentioned. Also, as she mentioned, is found originally in the Russian Urals, now found in Iran, Pakistan, and in Namibia and Madagascar. When we talk about demantoid garnets, though, we're not talking just about those original deposits in Russia, which were found in this rock called the serpentinite. This was the original find, and often the serpentinite-hosted demantoids have this kind of rich, vivid, deep green color. However, the stones found in Africa in both Namibia and Madagascar are what we call skarn-hosted demantoids. It's found in a different type of rock, a different geological setting where there's not as much chromium going around. And so these stones never tend to have that rich green color that you can find in some of the top serpentine-hosted demantoids. The color is often lower saturation and lower tone, which can be a good thing because that lower saturation and lighter tone can often bring out that fire a lot better than in some of the deeper saturated greens. And as the geology differs and the cause of color also differs. So with serpentinite-hosted demantoids, often the color is caused by the presence of chromium. And so again, this is typical for a lot of minerals. You get this chromium absorption feature, allowing this green light to be transmitted through the stone. Now with skarn-hosted demantoids, the color is coming entirely from iron 3+. And so this is actually something I think a lot of people in the mineralogical community don't realize, that pure andradite garnet with only iron in the structure actually is a green color. It has kind of a yellowish green color in pure andradite. However, the color in those skarn-hosted demantoids caused only by the iron typically never gets as rich and deep as the chromium, because with the chromium, you also have that iron in the structure, but you're adding to the color by adding additional chromophores to the structure to absorb more light and to create a deeper, darker tone to the stones. Now we'll move on to grossular. So grossular is the aluminum-rich end member of the eugrandite series. It's a calcium aluminum silicate garnet. It occurs in a range of colors, including greens, pinks, oranges, yellows, and even colorless, as this example here on the left. So grossular is different from the demantoid garnets in that a demantoid is always going to have some color, because the iron is part of the structure and it necessarily absorbs some of the light going through it. But in pure end member grossular, it's going to be colorless because none of those elements in the structure actually absorb any light. Now, when the color tends to be green in tone and saturation, from kind of bluish green to slightly yellowish green, with enough saturation and tone, it can be called savorite. That's shown in this example here, this magnificent piece from Bruce Bridges, a really stunning example of a savorite garnet. So let's look at what's going on crystallographically and chemically in order to cause that color for savorite. In savorite garnets, these are vanadium dominant grossular. So it's grossular in which the color is dominantly coming from vanadium. There might be a little bit of chromium mixed in there, but for the most part, this color is dominantly caused by vanadium. So there's, in this example, there's 12,000 parts per million vanadium. So 1.2% vanadium, which is quite a bit, and only 1,000 parts per million chromium. So only about 0.1% chromium in the structure. We do see some chrome-rich garnets, which have almost no vanadium in them. And actually in this case, even though we often see things called chrome grossular, we actually think that chromium on its own is producing more of a kind of a brownish color in grossular garnet. So this is a spectrum of a chrome-rich grossular from Ethiopia. It's got 1,000 parts per million chromium and only 40 parts per million vanadium. And what you see is this absorption feature here, this chromium absorption feature is shifted a little bit to shorter wavelengths than it was in the vanadium-rich grossular. And so what actually happens is that in addition to this green transmission window, you also have a wider red transmission window in these chrome-rich grossular garnets. And this is kind of why you get this brown color, because you're adding a little bit of the red and the green together, which causes kind of a brownish color. It also allows, as I'll show in the next slide, for a little bit of a color change to be occurring in some of these stones. So in this photo of some of these Ethiopian grossular garnets with a lot of chromium in them, there's two photos. On the left is a photo taken with incandescent light. On the right is a photo taken with daylight equivalent illumination. And so you can see there's an obvious difference in the color of these stones between these two different illuminants. And that's because we have those two transmission windows, one in the red region and one in the green region. And the red transmission window tends to be favored in incandescent light, whereas in daylight, that green transmission window tends to be favored and brings out that green color more. So chromium on its own is really not a very good chromophore for causing green color in grossular garnets. You really need that vanadium in those grossular garnets to get a savorite. And I think that's all we have for today. So we'll turn it back to Robert and hopefully have some time to answer some questions.
That was fantastic. What a great blend of science and lore and everything else. Very nicely done. We do have lots of questions that came up. So let me just pick a few here. Could Raman spectroscopy identify emeralds with any certainty, assuming that there were no other instruments available?
Yeah, so Raman would be able to identify the mineral beryl pretty straightforward. We had a good reference database. So the thing with Raman spectroscopy is minerals all have these kind of unique Raman spectrum patterns. So if you had a reference material to go against, something you knew was beryl, you could compare your spectrum of your gemstone with that of a reference beryl Raman spectrum, and you should be able to identify it pretty well. And there are devices out there that would allow you to do that. You could use photoluminescence as well, which could be attached to a Raman spectrometer to look for that chromium fluorescence as well. That might tell you if there's any chromium in the stone.
Okay. All right. And there was also an anonymous question about bixbyte, the red beryl, and whether you know what causes its definitive color.
Yeah, in the red beryl, the color is coming from manganese 3+, which is a strong absorber, and it creates that rich red color by absorbing light at about 550 nanometers.
Mm-hmm. Okay. Someone wanted to know whether there was a developmental difference between green tourmaline and chrome green tourmaline. So, did they develop differently?
Yeah. So the iron tourmaline, so the L-byte rich tourmaline, which is green colored by iron, forms an environment where you probably wouldn't have a lot of chromium going around. So they're often formed in pegmatites. And the uvite and dravite, those are formed in often magnesium and iron-rich rocks. And magnesium and iron-rich rocks might be sort of like mafic igneous rocks, or they might have some influence from that. So you might form some chromium. You might have some chromium going around in the rocks where you form dravite and uvite because of the differing chemistry. And those tourmalines also may be more able to take in that chromium because of their crystal chemistry. So that's probably why there's this difference in the cause of color between these different tourmaline species.
Yeah. Okay, there were several questions about the dangers of irradiation in diamond and whether or not there are any good books or articles that might cover this topic.
I think the probably the best article, I don't remember the issue, but there was recently an article by some GI researchers on green diamonds in general. And I think they were fairly comprehensive with the different kinds of green diamonds and the different ways in which you can form it. So if you send me note after the talk, I can try to find that comment and send that link to them for that article.
Okay.
I don't remember the issue.
Judy, here's a question for you from Barbara Eidegger. She wants to know if peridot was one of the three gems used by the suffragettes to communicate their cause.
I believe it was. I think the colors of the suffragettes were that pale green of peridot and a purple color and white. And I'm not sure exactly why they chose those colors, but yes, I believe peridot was used. And that was about the time of the Edwardian period. So it was a popular stone.
Yeah, perfect, mm-hmm. Great. And then there's a lot of questions also about extraterrestrial gems. And so let me see here. Are palisadic peridots similar to carbonado?
Well, so there is this theory. I think there's still a lot of uncertainty about the exact origin of carbonado diamonds. There is a theory that they are the product of extraterrestrial impact. And so they could be considered extraterrestrial, I guess, but there's still some uncertainty, I think, in terms of their origin. The palisadic peridot would have been a little different in that it was part of the meteorite that actually impacted the Earth. It wasn't created by the impact itself. So it would have been some part of some foreign extraterrestrial body even before it hit the Earth's surface.
Okay. All right. And carbonado is diamond, if I'm not mistaken, right?
Yeah.
Okay. All right. There was a question about whether or not it's toxic to handle bloodstone. I don't know if anybody knows the answer to that.
I haven't heard that. I've heard malachite can, you know, the powder from that could possibly be toxic, but I don't think I've heard that about bloodstone.
Yeah, it shouldn't be. I don't think bloodstone's dominantly chalcedony, which is quartz, and hematite or other iron oxide. So right. It should be relatively inert, I think. Mm-hmm.
Well, you guys are doing great. I think we're down to the last. I'm going to pull two more questions here. From Ron Suddendorf, is umphocyte considered a jade?
Yeah, so we would consider umphocyte a jade. So umphocyte is also a piercing, but its chemistry slightly altered from jadeite. I was simplifying, I guess, a little bit in those slides, but there's the kind of pyroxene jades and the nephrite jades is maybe the more general breakdown between those groups. So umphocyte would be considered a pyroxene type jade, yeah.
All righty, and then let's pull one last one, which is, let's see here. Well, I think we've pretty much covered everything. I think we're good, at least for now. So I think you guys are off the hook for the questions at this point. So no more need to worry about that. And Aaron, I guess if you want to go to the next slide, I want to thank you both, Dr. Palke and Judy Colbert, and everyone who attended today. What a great talk this was. And please come and join us next time. We'll be looking at kimberlites, the volcanoes that carry diamonds. The speaker for that will be Evan Smith on March 25th. And so with that, I'd like to thank you both and everybody. And that's it. Thank you so much.
Thank you.
Thanks.
Take care.